Yes, thank you, and a big thank you to the organizers for inviting me in a wonderful conference part. So, let's start with a picture of cognition. That's really bad. I mean, it's called the cognitive sandwich. We have perception processes, one end of the cognition, then stuff happens in between, and we have output side action. So I think most of us agree this is a very bad picture of cognition. And it's only one way to make it worse. It's when you look a little man in between that's doing all the hard work. So this is pretty bad. But if we look at how, in practice, science progresses, there's a lot of aspects of this image that's still present. If you look at common visual research, this is by Victor Lange, what we see is that V1 starts with very small receptive fields and very simple detection devices like little edges. And they, when we grow up the visual hierarchy from V1 to OKT, the shapes get more complex, the classical fields, receptive fields become bigger, and there's a T-bulb represented there. On the other end, people working on action and intentions also have some sort of hierarchy. But it's the other way around. We start with something abstract, coffee, and then it gets translated to the context, to the immediate environment by making it more concrete. I have to grasp my cup, I have to bring it to the mouth, etc., etc. Now, if I put these two pictures together, this image emerges, in which I have one perception hierarchy, which results into a discrete conclusion of what's out there in the world, and I have one hierarchy that starts with this discrete description, this discrete state, and it needs to be translated to motor commands. So this, somewhere else I call this funnel vision, but since Uri is organizing this, I thought closet cognitivism might be a nice term as well. So there's very few people who would endorse such a model, but in the background it really shapes our thinking and interpreting data. By the way, I put some words on the line there. These are interactive things. So if there's anyone who doesn't know what cognitivism means, you can raise your hand, and there we go. Then I can go in. We go to cognitivism. It's prevalent in cognitive science since the 1960s, I think, the turn of, from behaviorism to cognitive science. It's the idea that cognition takes place in the brain. It's best characterized as information processing. It's based on representations and computation, and it needs to make sense of neutral and meaningless deliveries of the senses. That's, in a nutshell, cognitivism. Now, I think I promised in the abstract that I will be exposed to cases of classical cognitivism. I'm not going to do that today. I will instead provide two strands of evidence against this model, and then discuss some consequences for the notion of free will. And the first one stems from my work in pharma with Vittorio Gresa. And we asked ourselves, is the motor cortex causally involved in visual perception of 3D objects in this case? As suggested by the notion of affordances. Anyone know, who does not know what affordances are? Oh, perfect. It was coined by James Gibson in the 70s, late 70s, and basically it's the possibility of an action on an object or an environment. We all know these doors. One side there's a plate to push, and the other side there's a handle. And I never tested, but I think if you just swap the words, 99 out of 100 people will still go through the door without a problem, because there's a very big, strong affordance to push here and to pull here. So creatures, James Gibson taught us, they interpret the world in terms of affordances. The affordances are not in the brain, they're not out there in the world, but they emerge from the interaction between creature and environment. So we asked ourselves in Parma, if these affordances are real, then there must be an influence of motor cognition on visual perception. So what we did, it's a bit tricky setup. We had participants judge simple shapes. These are 3D objects. They're big cubes, small cubes, big spheres, and small spheres. All the participants had to do was just tell us which of them they saw. That's what was the race. But we made it very difficult for them. First, it's in the dark, it's dark, and we only briefly flashed the object. That still wasn't too easy for them, so we came up with this device. We put this piece of glass at an angle of 45 degrees. And it's basically the one when now we look outside, it's dark in here, it's light outside, you can see through the window easily. But when it's dark outside, it's light here, you see the reflection of yourself. The same thing is happening here. If we flash the light here, you can see through it easily. If we flash it here, then we effectively mask the image. And by varying the intensity of the second flash, we can make it anywhere in here impossible or very easy. So we calibrated them to be around 70% correct. And then we applied TMS to the left rim of the cortex. And this is what we saw. If there's a TMS pulse of 150 milliseconds after stimulus onset, you see this significant increase in error rate. So people perform worse when they have a TMS pulse at the left rim of the cortex, 150 milliseconds after stimulus onset, compared to a condition 50 milliseconds after stimulus onset, which is too early for the remote cortex to have any role. And also compared to a condition where we stimulate the vertex, which is the top of the head, and which in terms of TMS doesn't do much. So, from this we concluded that left premotor cortex contributes to visual processing of 3D shapes. We don't think it can be explained as an action selection effect. There was no effect whatsoever on reaction times, and the reaction times were quite long anyway, 900 milliseconds, so it suggests a much more elaborate cortical loop than just a straight thinking with action selection. So this supports the notion of affordance. Your motor abilities, your grasping abilities, really do affect your visual perception. And it also, and that's important, it challenges cognitivism. Now on to the second line of the second experiment, which is still, I'm still analyzing data. This is based on the idea what was very nicely explained this morning by Eliot. When we study action intentions, in the limited sphere, the hallmark case, we do this as if action intentions are totally independent of any reason or any context. I mean, when these participants press the button, nothing happened after pressing the button. The context was totally free. In fact, they were instructed to not base their decision when to press on anything. Which is, well, strange. And also in more recent studies, these are two MRI studies, participants had to grasp the object here, and it's a meaningless object, only allows to grasp, so that's why it is designed this way. And also the context is totally devoid of any meaning. Now this approach to studying intentions as context-independent processes really assume that there is a context invariant core of intentions. So if there is, there's this process and all context just comes into this process and you do away with all the context and all meaning and all reason dependency, you might zoom into the process you're really interested in. But this assumes there is such an invariant context invariant core. If there's no such an invariant core, it's all context processing inverts different configurations, that if you do away with the context, you might throw out the baby with the bathwater. So this is what John and I asked ourselves. Is there any evidence for such a context in very poor? So what we did is we had participants, we presented them with a little picture indicating a context, in this case the breakfast context, and a reason for choosing one action or the other. So here it says you put poured the milk into your glass and you put the lid like, on the milk box. So what are you going to do? You have 6 seconds to think about this and then you have two options. Either you're going to place the milk box down again or you're going to open it. Well, you just poured in the milk, so you're not going to open it again. You put it down. So this did perform a lot of times. It's not really a free choice because, well, the reasons dictate what answer to give. But, this, just this morning I learned that it's called reflective control. So, But I think, well, I kind of like it this way, because in normal life you also act based on reasons. We don't wake up thinking, okay, I'm going to throw bananas at the ceiling. No, we get dressed because we need to get dressed. So I think it's a feature, not a bug. So the design, there's two actions, there is two contexts, a supermarket or breakfast, and there's two reasons per action. Okay, 20 repetitions per condition. And what we then did is we trained and tested a machine learning classifier to distinguish the intention to open from the intention to place. And we did this for different conditions in the MRI data. Now, we can do this in different ways. So there is five chunks of data, five different blocks. Four of them we use to train the classifier to distinguish, well, opening for this reason from placing for this reason. And then we have one fifth chunk of data, independent data, and that we can use to test this classification. So we can do it in the same configuration, so for the same reason, the same context. We can also do it for different reasons. We can do it for a different context, and both different contexts, different reasons. Now, and then to arrive at the result is a bit tricky as well. Let's see there. If we take these results, the classification for the same reason and for the same context, and we look at the brain, where in the brain, in one subject, subject number one here, can we accurately, above chat, classify the intention to open from the intention to place? And you see it's quite a widespread classification there. But if we then use this brain map to compare the conditions, we're doing something that's not statistically sound, because we found this brain map using one of the conditions, so we favor or we bias one of the conditions. So we put this little trick. We used all subjects except for subject number one, and we created a brain map based on the average of all these subjects, and we used this one to compare the conditions. Yeah, it's a bit tricky, but the results are less complicated. So we end up with a brain map like this, roughly, for each subject, and then we can see how the classification scores for different conditions. So the within context, within reason, corresponds to this brain map, and there's a highly effective above chance classification. Same goes for cross reasons, but there's less, it's a bit less, but I can still, the classifier still picks up this contrast. But there's no classification possible for the other two conditions. So if I change the picture from a breakfast to a supermarket context, the classification is really wrong. Now, what does this mean? Can we conclude the absence of an invariant core here? Well, that's of course tricky, because absence of proof cannot be considered proof of absence. But we can say a little bit more using Bayesian statistics. We first learned that Bayesian ANOVA, Bayes factor of 6, which is not stellar, but enough to perform the t-tests. So, and we then test the null hypothesis against the one hypothesis, and Bayes factor of 3.4316 suggests that this absence of classification is rather indicating moderate evidence for absence of effect rather than the presence of effect. So these results indicate that it's really doubtful that the processes underlying intentions have an invariant context independent core. It's doubtful, I mean, I cannot say put it much stronger than this, we need much more evidence, and you can doubt whether you can ever find evidence for absence of something. So the implications, I mean, what does it mean for neuroscience? We should really ask ourselves what invariance we find in experiments is really in the brain, and what invariance is in the experimental setup. And for philosophy, I'm coming from a rather embodied cognition point of view. I think these data suggest that also that we really study the interaction within the system, the interaction with the environment, and not the system as such. So this could help us overcoming straightforward commentism. For me, my own project, the notion of intention, there may not be discretely represented states underlying actions. I don't think there are any political activists in here, but there's people out there. I think there's really cognition is not about representations and computation, but representations. We talked about this, Peter. The world is its own best model, so we don't need to represent the world as long as it's there. And the same may be maybe true for the role for intentions. My intentions may not be in the brain, but rather in the way I respond to the world. So where do my actions come from then? This work with the philosopher with Dan Gerdsen from Tulane University. I can only go quite quickly, but what we think is going on is there's this perception action configuration. So it consists, it's not an extra layer on top of the lower layer, it just consists of percepts and motor programs and associations between them. And when I associate more of these perception action configurations in sequence, then we call it a structured perception action configuration. So we think that the solution lies in dynamic organization of sensory motor maps. Associations can be enhanced or reduced, and that's the crucial thing about it. We use the shopping list method for. So what I'm doing when I'm going shopping is that I make the list, the shopping list, but to not forget what I really need. But this list doesn't cause my behavior of going to the supermarket and buying all these things. No, when I'm in the supermarket and I'm down the pasta aisle, it enhances certain features of the blue boxes of the flavored pasta to grasp them. So it's not causing my behavior, but it's like enhancing associations. And that's, I think, wrong with the causal theory of actions. We tend to believe that their intention is in the brain and it's doing all the causal power. Well, in fact, there may be more stable states like this, but they don't have this role of intention as such. So, what about free will? How does this answer the question of free will? I also underlined free will. Is anyone who doesn't know what free will is? Well, don't worry. No one knows what hell is. So intentions do not cause action, running an execution process inverse from them. That's the role I have for intentions. It's quite different from the way intentions are currently conceived. So I'm not sure whether we should call it intention anyway or something else. And another related consequence is that the contrast between reflexes and deliberate action, or non-intentional versus intentional, or conscious versus unconscious, may not be as strict as we think it is. I mean, when we saw this model of all these perception action couplings, some of them are quite reflex-like, and my behavior emerges from orchestrating these reflexes and associating them in certain ways. So part of the action are intentional, part of them aren't, part of the conscious, part of them aren't. So that, I think, as far as I can go stipulating the consequences of free will. So let me end by thanking these people I work with and thanking you for listening.